start if you agree. Okay, welcome everybody, or welcome back to Romanian American University. We are honored to host another event from the Free Market Roadshow. The title is World After Brexit and Trump. Trump and America First is already in charge. And Brexit seems to have a starting point in a few days, 29th, I believe, of March officially. It seems to be the official date. And we hope that the debate will be a very nice one with different points of view, with questions and arguments in order to help us to clarify this kind of world after the Brexit and Trump. Thank you again, everybody, for being here today. We hope that it will be possible to meet you with many other occasions in the future. And now I will ask Mr. Bonjo to be the moderator of the conference, to have the floor and to manage the meeting.
Thank you very much. Welcome also from my my part. And of course, I will just take 1 minute of your time by saying a few words and then introducing the speakers. As an, let's say, administrative issue, I will kindly ask the speaker to synthesize their presentation in about 15 minutes in order to have some interaction with the room. About the title of this conference and then about the title of the first panel. As Mr. Rector mentioned, both events referred to in the title are in fact going to happen. So I look forward to the presentations because probably will be a lot of exploration of what if and then different hypotheses, and it's good to be prepared and explore the hypotheses. As for the topic of this panel, indeed there are a lot of discussions about the state of free trade at a global level, and of course the title is rather dramatic, but I think that from time to time, and especially when time to time means decades, it is normal that there is some, let's say, adaptation and, of course, the rules of the game have to reflect the balance of power and the balance of development among different parts of the world according to the respective historical moment. It is clear that the situation in the world nowadays is rather different as compared with 1945 or even with 1990. This being said and mentioned, I will give the floor to our keynote speaker. This is Barbara Holm. Just a few words about her. She is the president of Friedrich Hayek Institute in Vienna and director of the Austrian Economic Center, and is, let's say, promoter of free market policies and issues related to competition, the regulation, and also, let's say, the world of tomorrow, the future of Europe and the future of the world economy. So with this, I give the floor to Mrs. Holm and look forward to your presentation. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. I hope this works now with the technical.
Yeah,
it's okay. Good. So first of all, Mr. Rector, thank you for hosting us again. It's a pleasure to be back here at this wonderful private university and to debate with you the, well, the future, not only of Europe, but also of the world, because as we all know, things are interwoven these days. We live in a globalized world. We cannot close our doors and protect protect ourselves from outside. And there are different views that can be debated, and I would simply be very provocative right now at the very beginning, because if we do not discuss openly, and if we do not dispute or have a fair dispute about arguments, it will not get us anywhere, and we will be trapped in the so-called fake news or in the media, in the well-meaning media that is simply copy-pasting from one continent to the other and delivering their own opinion without looking at the real facts and without looking at the numbers and without looking at the consequences of things. And this is why I would like to start out, and this is also why we chose this topic, the world of the Brexit Trump. Not only that the Austrian economist, the late Friedrich August von Hayek, died 25 years ago, it will be 25 years, and he gave us, with The Road to Serfdom, one of his very important books, he gave us a legacy. And in this legacy, he described exactly what it means to be trapped within a totalitarian state, whether it's from the left or from the right, whether it's socialism, communism, or ultra-right. It's always sort of totalitarian. And he explains in this work why individual liberty is so important, why we as individuals count and make decisions and act and not society or government. And this is something, it's a precondition that we need to understand. This is the first thing. The second thing he argues, and this is also important to understand, that whatever totalitarianism it is, whether from the right or from the left, these regimes tend to grow government, tend to have all the activities and the decisions on their side, and keep forgetting about what the individuals can do and what can be done on the private level. So we have the tendency that, you know, governments grow and grow and grow. And then he also argues there is a certain detachment from the political elite to those people who vote for them and who pay the taxes. And this gap is growing and growing. And we have seen that in Europe. We've seen it with Brexit, and the detachment of the elite is simply, and also the arrogance, and this is where Hayek comes in again, with his pretense of knowledge in society, where he says, you have to look at what people think, and you have to work with them, and you have to look at the humane part, and not the technocratic, and this is where we are right now in Brussels. We've had bureaucrats with the bureaucrats, and then now we have technocrats, or even worse, because they serve not only their own interests, but certain groups that they are being lobbied for. And this is not what the individual citizen needs and does. So without further ado, I claim that Hayek would have been a Brexiter because of what I've just explained. First thing. Second thing, and this is the topic that I would like to discuss with you, with Brexit and actually Trump and protectionism. If we look at Bastiat, the great French philosopher, who claims when goods cross borders, weapons will not. We have to keep that in mind. This is a very logic thing. And again, we live in a globalized world. We trade internationally, we exchange internationally, we work with iPhones, we have Facebook friends around the world, and it's as simple to be next door with everybody. But there are barriers. So President Trump made this, he claimed that he will make America great again. He will rise America from the ashes of what has been left in the past. This is all very dramatic. The point is, will you really make, I call it a mistake, close borders for trade? Will he really fall into this trap? Or will he eventually be wise enough and understand the consequences of what he does? And we've always seen those ups and downs, also in Europe, when we have more liberalized markets, when we had openings, especially with the EU, until the late 90s, early 2000 years, when markets were liberalized, when monopolies were broken up. But especially after the financial crisis, we turned back again. We left this open, this path of openness and of creating growth for everybody, and went back to this negative ideas of regulation and over-regulation. And don't get me wrong, we need to make sure that the rule of law is constantly in our focus. But the rule of law doesn't have anything to do with the over-regulation that we see that comes out of Brussels, and that is destroying markets as well. So what are the options that or what is the underpinning of anti-protectionism, I would put it this way. It's a division of labor. It's as simple as that. You all know Adam Smith and the pin factory example, but I can give you another example of our pro-market groups with the Free Market Roadshow. It's not that, you know, our friends here in Bucharest have, for example, the knowledge of, or know exactly a professor who would fit into this model that we run, or that that they know a certain individual who would match or would attract you. We are lucky, we as sitting in Vienna, being the net hub of many other groups, that we know, for example, Professor Bernstein, whom you will hear later, Daniel Kadis, who has been here on the ground, but not always cooperating with the university here. So it's us who bring this knowledge here, and our friends here at the faculty, thank you very much for hosting us again and for organizing everything, know you and bring us together for the debate. So this is nothing else but the division of labor. It's as simple as that. And if you work, for example, do your homework or your classes, one of you is an excellent researcher and knows which books he has to look up. The next one is perfect in providing PowerPoints. And the third person is an excellent presenter. That is the division of labor in practice. And this is what we all do every day, and we create added value with that. And this is what markets are about. This is what globalization is about. This is what trade and the sharing is about. So these are important preconditions. You all know Deirdre McCloskey. One of her books is outside on the book table, and she's been speaking here. Deirdre McCloskey has been explaining, as an economic historian, of when wealth really took off. This was when we started to share, when we started to divide labor, and we started to cooperate. Cooperation is, I think, a magic word, and we should look into that. Although we love individualism, but this doesn't mean that we as individuals don't share. And because the creation of knowledge in society, as Hayek has written in his books, and was also why he was awarded the Nobel Prize, is that it starts from the individual. But we share it and create something new and are innovative. So these are the simple things. Another issue that you should also keep in mind, David Ricardo, no need to explain this at an economic school here, but the actor that we have put here, Chuck Norris, he claims that he does his thing best, and he has proven that, but he would not have been as successful if he had not met other people who were better in other things. The example of the doctor that is on the slide here is as simple as any other. So we create comparative advantages. And this is something that brings us forward. So now, the biggest issue, if we look into the topic of protectionism, is tariffs. What is the consequence of tariffs? They are a price for trading. The consequence will be higher prices of the goods, it will be lower wages, it's inefficiency, it's of course slower progress and growth, and if we look at the long-term costs, certain industries will completely be destroyed. You all know this easy t-shirt example, when for example one country A produces t-shirts at the price or sells them at the price of say 10. Country B produces the same t-shirts and sells them at the price for 5 and exports them. All of a sudden there is a tariff because let's look at America. And all of a sudden, the president says, I don't like those Mexican t-shirts any longer. We have to put a tariff on them. So they are not sold for 10 or for 5, but he adds an additional 10 to it. So they are not competitive anymore because they will be sold for 15, whereas the maybe less good product from the US with 10 will be sold for 10. So the Mexican producer says, well, I'll leave this market. I'm not gonna sell those any longer, which is logical because he will not sell any for 15. What is the consequence? That the American consumer cannot spend those 5 that he would have spent on US products or on any other product, or if he could have saved the money as well. So this is the issue that we face here. It's in the end, the consumer, it's always the individual who pays the price for bad policies. And this is why we have to be careful. So eventually, prosperity can only be created if we allow free trade. But if we don't, we will have a problem. And I think Mr. Trump understands exactly that. So he will have to create or find a solution to get out of his promises that he has made during the election campaign. We do not know yet how we will find a way out. We can only hope, as you know, as global citizens and as individuals, that there will be no stop in free trade. But of course, there are solutions that we all immediately know about, and we have been discussing them, and we have seen them. However, I would not even call those free trade agreements solutions. I would simply go further. They are a precondition, and they have been working in the past very well. But nonetheless, those things are not discussed on the real level, on the real problems. We discuss chlorine-washed chicken or gene-manipulated corn and things. These are just side debates. The real issues are, you know, the regulatory harmonization of the trade processes, and of course the secrecy, and here it is, IP, the protection of intellectual property rights. This is something that we need to consider. If you invent something, you want your property protected. Or you say, okay, it's open for everybody, but it should be your choice. It should be the choice of the inventor, of the creator, and not done by government. So those are the things we need to discuss. So I call these debates the solutions, it's managed trade and nothing else. And there will be, if you manage it, especially via government, top down, there will be winners and losers. And the winners are those who have the better lobbyists, and the losers are the consumers in the end. And the small and medium-sized companies who are unable to articulate themselves in a way as the big lobby groups. So even if you are for free trade, as I am, and you know, Bastiat for me is the most important sentence if we discuss trade, when goods cross borders, weapons won't. Then we have to be very critical if we look at the trade agreements that we have discussed in the past. Because do thousands of pages of paper help the cause when we can say simply, you know, a deal is a deal? We can trust each other, or we should trust each other. It's the old law of thousands of years back where people traded and trusted each other. And if you look at, for example, the Uber issues or the Airbnb issues, things, or whatever you buy online, you immediately judge and immediately give the information, this person that I bought the service from is trustworthy. You immediately give them their points or your points. And this information is important. And this is the information that the market provides, and not government. It's the information that the city, that the consumer gives. So the question is, and I'm very provocative, do we really need all those trade agreements? Of course, from a libertarian point of view, you could say, okay, the best solution is unilateral free trade. If country A calls country B, or President A calls President B, and says, guys, we open our borders for your products, feel free to import. But vice versa, we want you to do exactly the same thing. Does it sound logic? Should work, actually. Especially given that the citizen, the consumer, can immediately say, hey, this product is not good. This is fake. This is copy whatever of XYZ. This is not original. This is not good. So we as the consumers are in a much better situation these days than we were even 30 years ago, before we had those nice little tools, or 20 years ago. So the question is, can we make and push forward to create more added value for everybody? Because in the end, you know, we will be the winners. Everybody is the winner. This is what about economics, what about markets are. Creating added value for everybody. It's a win-win situation. As simple as Adam Smith has put it a long time ago in his Wealth of Nations, with the example of the butcher. I give you only one more example, what we have to look at if we look at Europe and the European Union. This is Estonia. Estonia, before it joined the European Union, was, you know, very smart. Of course, you can always argue it's a small country, only 1.3 million inhabitants, and you know, things go easier there because everybody knows everybody, but they did their job. They did their homeworks. They did a lot of structural reforms back then. And they had open borders and they traded freely. And then when they joined the European Union, they had to go under the trade regime of the European Union, which of course forced them to be less open, to put additional tariffs on, etc. And this is what happens in Europe, or is currently the fact in Europe. So if let's say, if Trump does the same thing, this wall is not that is much higher, and he will harm the US consumer and the US citizen much more by protectionism than he thinks at the moment right now. So the solution for all of us should be unilateral free trade in general. And if we need, we can add treaties to that. But of course, this was now a little bit provocative, because it's never, in the real world, it's never black and white. We all know we need to adapt, and there is no such thing as an ideal world, as we all know. We all face the consequences. So Trump is in a certain position that he has to make the right solutions, because eventually he will not be reelected. If people start suffering, and if the markets break down, if the wages go down, if people cannot buy the right products. So we can only hope that he will make the right decisions. Secondly, you know, Brexit is a very interesting topic, because Brexit, if this happens, we can argue the EU wants them to pay, I think Daniel has the numbers exactly, 60 billion that they owe the European Union. The Brits can say, you know what, sorry, we don't care, forget about it. We go ahead and just cut our taxes. We create a complete free trade area. We open our trade and borders, and we create our financial hub. Would be a solution. They will be competitive. It's all about competition. So each, whatever way a politician or an entrepreneur or an individual walks, as soon as he's more competitive than others, he will win. And this is, I think, something that we as individuals, and especially you as the next generation, should keep in mind, that it's about trustworthiness, it's about self-responsibility, it's about competitiveness. If you are able to compete with others because you're smarter, faster, more creative, then you're on the right track. And I think this is something that we need to keep in mind. This doesn't mean that you don't take your responsibility for others, but it's not the state or the government's responsibility to care for other people. It should be society's. And this is the big gap, the big divide that we see these days in the US, where we have half of the population who says, okay, government takes care of that. Government should solve our problems. Government will cradle us, as we do in Europe, with welfare states in Western Europe. And on the other hand, you have people who believe in their own abilities, in their own qualities, in their own power to solve their issues themselves. And as an individual, I would rather suggest we should first look at our capabilities before we turn to others and ask for a handout. Thank you.
Subjects from the point of view of some person really involved in day-to-day business. So with this very brief introduction, I give you the floor. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm quite surprised because I didn't know that I was the first. So the pressure
yeah, it was
on my
of a change.
We're living in a changing world.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
uncertainty.
Yeah. Thank you anyway for this invitation. It's always a pleasure and a great honor to be here in such a, let's say, quality audience, which deserves to be even wider and bigger, and I'm happy that it's growing from year to year as number. It should be bigger in order to be able to spread the words of freedom until the freedom will ring, as Martin Luther King used to say, until we should be able to join hands together and sing Let the Freedom Ring. And this because the major reconfiguration, if we go on the title of the theme, the major reconfiguration which is happening in the world nowadays, I consider it's the end of free in a wider sense, not only on the free trade. It's the end of free and growing of governmental intervention. We're experiencing an expansion of the etatism, and due to the fact that the audience here is rather young, as I see, and maybe some of you will want to go in the entrepreneurial environment when you will finish university, so on. And being as an entrepreneur, I will focus on a point that draw my attention in this spring. It's a phenomenon that it's happening not only in Romania, but in the whole world, in Europe mostly, but in this spring in Romania happened to be more visible. More concrete, I'm speaking about the governmental intervention on the last frontier, meaning entrepreneurship, business creation, through programs like free money for entrepreneurs. I don't know if you are familiar with Startup Nation, this program, which is very, let's say, mediatized. It's very covered by the media in this spring. And you know, there is a saying in the business that that says that the best money to have a business is other people's money. Now the Romanian government is taking this phrase to a bigger scale. Because these programs are practically done with no co-financing. No co-financing, and it's given very easily to wannabe entrepreneurs, let's say. What is an entrepreneur, practically? An entrepreneur is a person who identifies a need in the society, who bring together in a creative manner the factors of production in order to satisfy this need, to assume the risk of the capital, the risk of the financial involvement, let's say, in order to maximize the profit. Practically, this is a definition of an entrepreneur. And in this kind of program, practically, this issue of risk, taking the risk, it's not existing. So it's kind of free money, which is giving an idea that the capital is free, and it's modifying the whole perception about the cost of doing a business. Why I'm saying this? It brings three logical programs, these kind of programs, on three logical issues. On one hand, if the profit is the reward of the risk, and the entrepreneur is the one who should take the risk. Is an entrepreneur founded by the state, entitled morally to dividends of the profit? This is a philosophical question, but it's we should ask ourselves if these kind of founded entrepreneurs are entitled to profit. Or another logical issue could be market is a best form of resource allocation. Isn't this programs, aren't these programs a way of subsidizing inefficiency of all the parties involved and also of the wannabe entrepreneurs? Or another logical problem, it comes from the argument that you know, these programs are creating jobs. They are calculating that, okay, we finance 20,000 jobs and 10,000 business and each of them two jobs. So we create 20,000 jobs, which is not very fundamental also this. despite the fact that we are not focusing on creating jobs in such a program, we are focusing on entrepreneurship, so not on social security, but these jobs are not given to the people who don't have jobs. So I can take a person from another business, so it's not job creation. We don't count jobs two times, you know. So also this kind of argument is not sustainable in practice. So usually a business, a profitable business, can get financing from the private investor. I don't think that the funds who are offered, let's say, through the state, but they are, these funds are coming from the taxpayer, practically should be dedicated to high risk investments, because this is kind of programs. These kind of programs are high risk, let's say, investments. So we see is that entrepreneurship entrepreneurship is transforming into social protection. We don't, and this is the last area where social protection should be. We cannot provide this type of resources to business started by entrepreneurs and affecting in this way the real entrepreneurs. Because, for example, if I'm developing a hotel, a small hotel in a part of the country, and in 2 years from now, it coming some European funds or governmental funds who provide to another person 90% free money, and he is making the same business near me. What will be the result, practically? The entrepreneur who invested will be out of the market, because he cannot offer to the same price as the entrepreneur who is financed by with free money with 50% or 70% or 90%. So what we will have after 5 years? A broke entrepreneur, a broke investor, and a person who just have a renovated house, let's say, or a new house, which brings me to another, let's say, level or projection in the future, that in the future it might be that there will not be profitable business unless they are financed by the state. In the last 10 years, 27% of the entrepreneurs, let's say, took money from the state in one form or another. You know, it's only 10 years. And we can imagine how fast this is growing, and maybe in 20 years, where will be? I didn't start business with money from the state, that's why I'm saying this. I'm thinking that I cannot start another business in 2 years unless I will have money from the state, because otherwise I'm in a very big danger. So these kind of programs is nothing related with free market anyway, and have a very big kind of risk from moral perspective. Now I'm not encourage you not to apply, because once these programs are, what can we do? We should take this money, because otherwise, as I argumented, you could be put it out from the market by people who financed with the money from the state. So you should take this money, but we should not forget that, and we should not, let's say, avoid to put our opinion that this is a poisoned kind of gift given by the governments. And when you enter with the governmental funds in the area of entrepreneurship, practically you are threatening the last mile of freedom from this perspective, because in 20 years you could have only businesses financed by the state remaining, small businesses financed by the state. What the entrepreneur need instead? You know that Ronald Reagan said at some point that the most threatening words for an entrepreneur is I'm from the government and I'm here to help. What entrepreneurs need instead of this free funding, it's less bureaucracy. It's people with purchasing power, so low taxes. It's less bureaucracy in order to develop business. So they just need to be left to develop and to risk, because also the risk, it gives you motivation to succeed. So if you don't have risk, practically your motivation to succeed is decreasing. So the statistics about failure will be even worse. You know that 80% from the new business are failing after a few years. So imagine that if you have no risk, how many businesses could fail if the financing is disappearing from the state? So you are subsidized in the first part of activity by the state, and then you will not be subsidized, but your business starting without, let's say, a need from the market. It started because the state gave you money in some area. So there is no allocation of this resourcing relating the needs. Practically, this part, which means the risk assumed, it's a very important part for an entrepreneurial project, and this makes an entrepreneur to be very involved and to take care a lot with deep attention and responsibility toward his business. In the end, concluding is that the best allocation of the money is done by the people who are producing that money. So, you know, if anybody had any doubt about the state being the worst administrator, you know this sentence, let's say, this kind of project with free money, I guess, avoid all the doubts. And I think there is a lot of room for improvement in this kind of area, and which is influencing practically the free market overall. Thank you.
Practical approach and market oriented. Of course, we'll have some time for discussion at the end of the panel, but I think somehow we need to have a brief intervention here. We should not forget that the European Union is a social market country. This is in the treaties. So if we want to be consistent, then as Barbara mentioned, when she said that maybe Hayek would be a Brexiter, then if we, let's say, are along these lines, then probably we should be out of the European Union, or if we are within, then it's a social market economy that subsidizes this type of businesses. But this is a good intervention. Now I will invite
you. Social market economy. It's the wording in the treaty.
so far.
Competitive social market economy is the trick. So.
Okay, so I will invite Mr. Cristiano Paun, distinguished professor from the University of Economic Studies, to this presentation. You have the floor.
Thank you for this opportunity. My presentation will be about Brexit and about how liberal is this situation, this process today. And move to the first slide. First of all, I want to highlight the idea of doing this by United Kingdom. And I want to I tried to find some reasons about doing this today. First of all, United Kingdom decided to exit from European Union, in my opinion, due to the position of United Kingdom that was constantly undermined by other countries. Normally, United Kingdom apply the liberal position there, fighting for reforms, for more markets, less redistributionism in European Union. The other countries like France, like Italy, southern countries, totally opposed to this position. So for United Kingdom, the latest years was quite complicated, and this is, in my opinion, one of the most important reasons for Brexit. The second one is the history of United Kingdom with European Union. As you know, United Kingdom is not a founding member of European Union, was not invited, in spite of the words of Winston Churchill in 1946 that said, we need to create a United States of Europe. So there are a lot of politicians in United Kingdom that were in the favor of this United States of Europe. So in spite of this, United Kingdom was not invited. They applied in 1957 and France refused the accession of United Kingdom. They reapplied again, and finally they were accepted. So this history with European Union proves that United Kingdom was not quite welcomed in this group of countries. And I want also to highlight another argument for Brexit, from my opinion, the failure of redistributionism. United Kingdom, it's a very, very big country. If we are looking to the GDP per capita, its economic performance. It's like in case of a classroom where professor is redistributing the results between the students. So in this case, United Kingdom, it's a very performance student. And United Kingdom saw that the results, economic results of this country, constantly were redistributed to other non-performing countries. So in this case, this is a very inconvenient situation. So Brexit could be explained by these things. But if we are looking to the arguments for Brexit and arguments against Brexit that have been declared when the Brexit were promoted, in United Kingdom, I do not think that this Brexit was argued by very liberal arguments. First of all, I want to discuss about the first one, higher independence, to pursue the interests of this country in relationship with the others. One of the main problems of United Kingdom was the relationships with the other countries that are part of Commonwealth. European Union significantly blocked the relationship with Australia, Canada, and other countries that are significantly linked to United Kingdom. Okay, higher independence. If this higher independence is transformed into good things, into more trade with this kind of countries that will replace the original trade with countries from the European Union, maybe we can accept that this argument is a liberal one. Higher control on migration. Okay, if I am a liberal, I'm fighting for migration because the freedom to move from a country to another, it's a right that should be defended. Yeah, of course, by accepting that the people migrating will respect my property rights and so on. Higher control on migration. Okay, this is not a liberal argument in my opinion. Separation from bureaucratic Brussels. Okay, but in case of United Kingdom, we are talking about institutions, public institutions. They will not replace, they will not reform their own public institutions. These institutions will continue to act in the relationship with their people. We are not seeing a reduction of the state due to this Brexit in case of United Kingdom. So the bureaucracy still exists in United Kingdom and will continue to exist. Better trade for the United Kingdom. I do not think that this is a very easy achievement, and you will see why when I will give you some numbers about this. The contribution to EU budget. Okay, United Kingdom paid a lot to the European Union budget, but also they received a lot of money from European Union. The balance is negative, but it's not so much negative if we are looking to the per capita contribution. And the last argument, a reduction of prices due to Brexit. So these are the main arguments that I found in media, economic literature about sustaining the Brexit. Not so many liberal arguments, not so many arguments about more free market, more free movement of people, capital, less barriers to enter and to exit from European from United Kingdom due to this Brexit. Arguments against Brexit. Again, we saw a reduction, a lot of them are very debatable, a reduction of economic growth. They claim that exiting from European Union, this will reduce the economic growth of the United Kingdom. The Brexit will limit the access of United Kingdom to very important European markets. A depreciation of British pound, unemployment rate that will be higher, increasing inflation, investments and so on. I wanted to present these arguments in order against Brexit, in order to see that again we cannot see some arguments that are linked to the idea of economic freedoms, improvement of state, reforming the United Kingdom, a better reforming of United Kingdom due to this to this Brexit. I want also to discuss a little bit about the solutions, and of course we have the solution today for Brexit because they announced the solution, but at the initial moment the five solutions were available. First of all, to keep the current status of European Union member state by rejecting the result of referendum. They totally rejected this idea today. To reconsider the European Economic Area membership of Norway solution. This was very complicated for United Kingdom because United Kingdom, it's a big country, and Norway that is now today the main country in the European Economic Area does not accept the idea of coming back to the initial situation of this group of countries. And also, in this case, United Kingdom still continue to pay a lot to European Union, but the voting right will be totally cut. So Norway's solution from the perspective of United Kingdom was totally refuted, especially due to the fact that they will continue to pay, they will have a limited control on the budget of the European Union and on the vote, and they will continue to accept the migration policy of European Union. To negotiate a bilateral agreement with European Union, in my opinion, this is the one of the most liberal one, because in case of Switzerland, there are a lot of referendums for the biggest problems of relationship between European Union and Switzerland. This is not available for United Kingdom, in my opinion, because the size of United Kingdom is different and the problems of United Kingdom are different. So problems are different, and for this reason, this solution was also rejected today. And the remaining two solutions, to negotiate a free trade agreement with European Union or to apply the World Trade Organization rules, maybe this will be the most accepted solutions, one of them maybe. But these solutions are very sensitive, because if we are looking to the current situation of European Union, we can see the following. First of all, United Kingdom has a negative commercial balance with European Union, meaning that United Kingdom is importing more than export to European Union, so it's totally dependent on the economy of European Union. If we are looking to the exports, we can see that exports outside of European Union compared with exports inside of European Union, we have the following data. First of all, I want to say that the volume with United States, one second, because there are data, so I need to read them a little bit. Okay, few numbers. Let's suppose that European Union, the United Kingdom will totally quit the relationship with European Union and will start to trade with any country. Normally, trying to replace the trade with former European countries with other countries that are close to this country. The total export to United States is $51 billion today. The export to Germany is $46 billion, $34 billion with Netherlands, and $27 billion with France. So if United Kingdom will close the relationship with European Union, a major part of these exports that are today with European countries will be blocked by various barriers, and the United Kingdom will be forced to replace a lot of these exports with other countries. And it's very difficult, because we are talking about huge volumes, but also we are talking about a very, very limited structure of these exports. United Kingdom today exports 46 billion cars, 37 billion as gold, crude oil and refined products 45 billion, and medicines $20 billion. So four products, two of them manufactured products, cars and medicines, but two of them are raw materials, oil and refined products and gold, are dominating the exports of this country. I think that will be very difficult for United Kingdom to negotiate with European Union from this position and having this structure of exports, and will be also very difficult to find new exporting countries today that will accept this kind of volumes and this type of products. So the next period of time will be very, very sensitive. And if we are looking to the global situation, a lot of countries that now are talking about protectionism and so on, will be very difficult also for United Kingdom to find partners, reliable partners. Let's talk about United States, for instance, that declare their protectionism today. So the Brexit, I think that will be a long story, And I think that maybe we can see a very, very clear change after 1 year, 2 years of hard negotiations with European Union and maybe with other countries in this case. Anyway, my conclusion is the following. Brexit is today conducted by politicians. This process is not driven by markets, by private forces, and by entrepreneurs or something like that, their representatives or their groups. This process is dominated by politicians. They will negotiate, they will propose solutions. And I'm not convinced that the result of such negotiations will be in the favor of more economic freedom, minimizing the state, reforming the social services in United Kingdom. I give you an example. When Brexit was presented to the people, they said something like that: "We are paying 5 billion." Pounds to the European Union budget, it will be better for us to take the money from that budget and to spend the money for public services in United Kingdom." So this was the message, not a word about how to reform, how to improve the services. They said something like that: "We will replace the money spent there the money that will be spent here." I'm not convinced that they will not continue to subsidize the agriculture of United Kingdom. They will not continue to do a lot of things that they are done inside of European Union. So the welfare state of United Kingdom that is very, very, very developed, if we are looking at least to the healthcare system of United Kingdom, will be reformed. So for me, Brexit is not a liberal story due to that idea, and I think that will not necessarily conduct to a more liberal world and so on. Thank you.
Now I give the floor to Mr. Fabian Joa. He's an associate professor with the University of Economic Studies here in Bucharest, and also a well-known journalist having a lot of projects, and if I'm to mention the newborn magazine, The Market for Ideas, is just to show that he's always open to new approaches and to studying the changes that are taking place in the world here and in the world economy. So I give the floor to Mr. Shura, please.
Thank you very much. I'm not necessarily feeling comfortable or not being in control. The remote controller. This is a small detail in life. Not everything around you should be handy. At least ideas must have to also be handy. This is the essence of misreading, which is heavily enrooted in common sense, which is the only kind of communism I strongly advocate and I'm comfortable with. So common sense should rule, and my feeling is that in case of trying to discern among Trump's speeches and actions, common sense is very, very scarce animal. If I were to have a motto for this presentation, that should be inspired by one of the sayings of a famous American philosopher. He's a baseball philosopher. I'm pretty sure that someone in this room likes him very much. His name is Yogi Berra. He said that not everything I have said until now, I really said. This is the case with my presentation. It could become clumsy. And it's definitely the case with Trump's assessments and expected endeavors in terms of politics and economics. He hadn't really said everything he said. So it's very hard to make the hermeneutics of Trump's philosophy, because his discourse is brilliantly gloomy. It has more than 50 shades of gray. Sorry for the remark, it's either passive. And it's burdensome to try to fight with his ideas once you consider them as being ideas by the natural definition of this word. So I try to be at least as erratic as Mr. Trump was. So sorry for disturbing you with my presentation. I start with a commercial. We are in a journal and media journal, and we have to take commercials between sports and weather. I've already mentioned something about sports, and afterwards I get weather. But now it's a commercial moment, and I want to introduce to the distinguished audience a magazine we've initiated and has a very generous name, hopefully a very generous destiny. It's called The Market of Ideas, and more or less coincidentally, the last two issues, which happen to be also the first two ones, have substantial dossiers dedicated to the problems of Brexit and Trump world. If you do not have anything else to do when you are staying at home and looking for trouble, please enter this website and try to get irritated by the arguments, which are not by far concentrated in the free market economics. The free market of ideas does not necessarily mean only free market ideas. This is what we built it as a free market, in order to let other reasons, not necessarily our tastes, even if informal reason, to decide which ideas should survive or prevail. I want to thank especially Professor Dumitru Miron and the Romanian American Foundation for the promotion of education and culture for supporting this project, which I strongly believe is not useless, at least. This is the backbone of this presentation. Some thoughts which I try to put together. It's more or less a bricolage, but I've take the risk of changing topics, but you feel free at the end of my presentation to clarify anything that was missed in my speech. First case is about pragmatism, which seems to be the doctrine, the doctrine is the doctrine of Trump administration. It's something that seems to convince at least half of the voting Americans. So it's a legitimate concern what lies beneath. If half of the American voting right, American population, we ignore the arithmetics between the American electoral system, agreed with the messages delivered by President Trump. Second topic is about trade and the relationship between Trump policies and Trumponomy. Trade is a very sensitive topic in Trump's discourse. Nevertheless, he considers himself a supporter of free trade. He's a free trader. I have a precise quote with this declaration and his own definition, because semantics in the end is politics. So you can name your ideas however you want. There is an ongoing passion for new speak, to remember Orwell, in political discourse. Trump didn't miss the opportunity to add his own philosophy to the regular vocabulary. Third topic is about borders and barriers, and I want to draw the attention that the logic that applies to free trade is not necessarily mimicked by the logic that should be applied to free movement of people. There are two different perspectives that should be very carefully separated in order not to produce great mess in the society, for instance, American or European modern society, which are very much under assault of this pleadings towards free movement, but without very strong qualifications. And the last thing is about how Trump sees immigration and what solutions he delivered for this. The essence of Trump's political philosophy is at least very common to any other politicians. He preaches what is good for the American people. We can agree with this. Every American politician preaches what is good for the American people. Every politician in the world preaches what is good for his country, national, electorate, and close supporters. What is in great need here is to explain what Trump's understands by good, what Trump understands by people, and what Trump understands by American. It's very high-end hermeneutics involved here. I'm not a specialist, I'm completely ignorant. But as far as I understand, there are some words which are used very interchangeably. Mr. Trump is the very expression of this forced synonymy in modern American political English. Pragmatism is patriotism, is populism, and is protectionism. One of the most difficult words, not to pronounce, but to absorb, is populism. But you don't need to get angry with the world before at least trying to understand what kind of sense does he or you attribute to this word, because populism could be at least separated into two directions. The populism that is favoring the acceptance of people's rights as they naturally are, or populism as creating and defending newly artificially created rights. These are two different kinds of populism. You have to understand very clearly when you speak against populism, which kind of populism do you reject? Natural populism, which speaks of hardworking, self-sustaining people, or the artificial populism, which speaks of protecting certain categories, large or small, from parts of the nations which you very exquisitely cut in order to obtain arithmetic majorities or small but powerful influential interest groups which you have to please before you enter the political landscape. They're all under the same umbrella of populism, but you need to make it clear which sense do you understand and sanction. Trumponomics is a philosophy which is the prolongation, in a sense, of Reaganomics, but reversing its trends. If Reaganomics was associated with privileging the accesses of the greatest good philosophy of the Wall Street and K Street, the corporatists and lobbyists, which are lording over the Main Street, the real economy, and ordinary people, these forces have been unleashed by Reaganomics. Now Trump aims to takes control in the name of the forgetting part of the nation over this social mechanism, political and economical, and trying to build his own narrative and, in the ultimate sense, his own nation, American nation, defined according to his beliefs and convictions. Trumponomics is only the last cry of, some say, traditional Republican protectionism. History is full of examples from early Republican tradition, even if recently Republicans, at least in the Cold War period, were heavily associated with liberalization in commerce, free trade, or freer, not necessarily free, freer trading. This is a very strong ancient tradition in Republican discourse towards protectionism, and there are some very explicit wording in this respect. Theodore Roosevelt, considered one of the most successful American presidents, had said that pernicious indulgence in the doctrine of free trade leads to fatty degeneration of the moral fiber. Sounds very Trump, and only was said 100 years ago by a representative of a political party which later on associated itself with freeing up economy, but only after the Reaganite revolution, which in a way can erase its historical roots of protectionism and interest group privilege, which are associated with early Republican administration. Trade. Trump's definition of free trade is free trade among equals. It's not necessarily the sense of equality that a natural law doctrine assumes. It's equality among nations in terms of policies with respect to the production of goods and treatment of labor in their jurisdiction, which could in somehow be put on some foot level and should be from this point on regarded as free and fair at the same time. Free trade in Trump's view is happening only between countries with similar levels of development, with same regulatory burden and the same costs with labor force. When all these are relatively equal, the free trade is allowed to spur. Of course, we are speaking here of a battle between hampered comparative and competitive advantages, but this is not the problem for Trump. Trump wants to see nations which treat their constituents equally. So in this sense, they could be permitted to freely engage in commercial relations to another. This is why Trump's rhetoric does not refer to Canada or Germany or necessarily to the European Union, but Mexico and China, which he sees as dangerous for their manifest and sustainable social dumping, which threatens the life and wealth of the American commoners. The last topic, I'm not necessarily end of my presentation with the problem of migration because it's quite popular, but I want to emphasize something on the principal distinction between borders and barriers, which are very ambiguously conflated nowadays in modern discourse. And I think it could be a good exercise to try to split them apart. There are two great dangers, at least in my view, which I'm a classical liberal, libertarian, shame in American Vibiage, in classical liberal in European one. There are two great enemies for the communities nowadays. One comes from the top, the other comes from below. There's on one hand supranationalism, the delegation of sovereignty, and widening of the gap between authority and citizen. And on the other hand is the problem of multiculturalism, instilling alien cultural elements in communities above their head. This is the case, at least what he considers to be in many of the American communities. This is the case in Europe. Not necessarily is a problem with losing the sense of utility in the economic equation for certain individuals, but there's a sense of violation of their own habitat because of policies which try to accommodate artificially cultural diversity, which is good only as long as naturally metabolized by communities and not overimposed of them. I have some reasons for which borders are essential in human existence. We all use it, even if we call it walls, fences, or city gates. The sense of order and separation, the sense of merriment, tomb, starts and ends with this sense of belonging and sharing, which should be voluntary, unhampered, if wanted to be consistent. The problem is not with borders, but is with barriers against the will of the individuals composing a community. These are detrimental for both material wealth and spiritual welfare when imposed by authorities in the name of greater good and superior knowledge. I will thank you and shut my mouth.
Thank you very much. contemplating the coffee break, but let's have 5 minutes for questions and answers or comments. So please.
I'd like to commit suicide in front of you. After my speech, I'll probably lose all my friends. I'll be alone, but you know, one can mend alone without being distressed. I'm going to say good things about Trump. I'm not going to answer your accusations. Going back and forth sometimes doesn't help. And but I'm going to say some parts that I consider positive. Who am I, basically? I'm a conservative with libertarian tendency. What do I disagree? It's on foreign policy, but that's another talk. And I lived for 42 years in the United States. And I have got a little bit of a feeling of living into a so-called multicultural society. Let me put it this way. I don't know about you people, but there's something that's happening, and it looks like it's the elephant in the house, completely ignored by a lot of people. It's called political correctness. Political correctness is probably the most personal view and shared by some others, the most dangerous act in today's society. Why? Briefly, without getting into why Marxism couldn't do economically destroy the society. Political correctness, in fact, is doing it from a moral point of view. Ecologically, segregation, name it. All the evils, therefore, has to be exchanged. Somebody who had the courage to stand up and talk against all the liberal media, which I despise, sorry about that, okay? And where the chief chaplain is, the leader, the pope of the political correctness, it's the New York Times, okay? Somebody came up and say, you know, I hate you all. I say, my God, he's suicidal, you know. Who would dare to go against the media, the part of the media, that media, which is the mainstream media considered, okay? He had the guts to do it. Second, while Mr. Obama never pronounced the word terrorism. He was afraid that, you know, politically it's not really something that you might say. Trump has it's an asset and liability. He was never a politician. Now, you can take it and accuse him that he never ran an organization, a political organization, that's on a liability side, or on a positive side, that he never has to, you know, manage things and present things with a 3 pair of gloves in which, you know, things has to be acceptable and constantly think, oh my God, if I say that, what's gonna say the other one and what gonna? He came quite abrupt, and being there, every time he, you know, put his foot in his mouth, as they say, you know, the next day, the newspapers say he's finished, he's gone, that's it, he blew it. And the ratings were going up, I don't know how. So I'm saying, Islam, it's a major problem, and when I meant the elephant, it is a big elephant in the house, okay? Now, as a libertarian, I have my own inner problems dealing with this idea, because I cannot accept a caliphate in America, okay? And Newt Gingrich put it in a much simpler way. He he say anybody who wants to become a citizen, you know, a Muslim wants to become a citizen, has to be asked, do you believe in Sharia law? Now, Sharia law, which is the core of the belief of the Quran, it is in total contradiction with the American Constitution, okay? And you guys, libertarians, my friends, I'm gonna let you handle this situation and find out. But I do not want to live in a country that wants to aggressively introduce a religion that's against my belief. Now, what do we do? Freedom of religion or my freedom? That's it. I'm not getting into that because it's too long.
Okay, please say something.
First of all, I think that liberty also goes against political correctness during elections. And you have Bernie Sanders, who was openly criticizing Democrats and Republicans. And it's different to compare Donald Trump with political correctness. He's just lying. And when he says that in New York, in Chicago, the rate, the criminal rates are higher on the 30s and 40 years old people relying on media and news, that's not correctness. It's a liar, and there's many facts and many times when he lied. He clearly lied about what he is saying. And, you know, I would compare Donald Trump with Kardashian. You can attract media by saying something right, like Lady Gaga, who also attract media, right? But you cannot attract, you know, media being Kim Kardashian and having a big ass and being very extravagant. I'm just saying this comparison to be understandable by younger people. I think what you said, that he fights against correctness, he doesn't fight against correctness with facts. He fights with the liars. And you have Bernie Sanders, who fight against correctness, political correctness, with facts. I'm sorry,
okay,
I just
thank
have
you.
To
I would kindly invite the next comments to be related, if possible,
yes,
to the subject of this panel. Okay, please.
Only one thing that I was dropping
okay,
to finish.
Let have that intervention.
Just to finish. One of the things that conservatives wanted for a very, very long time and then never achieved was to was to have a military budget that would inspire confidence in the world and cut the budget. For anybody who followed, you have seen that he has cut the budget.
Thank you very much.
And that's it.
Cut 40% from education.
We'll continue during the coffee
okay.
break. Thank you.
Well,
please.
That's what debates are for, especially when you have students and people from a variety of backgrounds. You get to see that passion is good. But my concern is how do we find the middle ground? And when I mean middle ground, not find the centristic position on some of these issues, but find a position that keeps account of these different trends. Because I feel like some of the, well, I'm very principled and I believe in the right doctrines. I believe that some of the approaches of 20 years ago, even 10 years ago, are obsolete and not fully giving results and answers to our predicament. Our first speaker talked about free trade, and I'm all for free trade. But for example, is it really free trade just to allow, let's say, imports coming to America? Or for example, some of them come from China, where the government gives subsidies and through the, is it really free trade when from India, you have a company who offers similar products to you in America, but their ecological rules are so different? Is it free trade with t-shirts from Mexico, when some of those ladies are working in sweatshops and mafia? So things are more complex. I know among many libertarians, like the company, like Uber is very popular. But for some people, is it really fair, or is it really competition on free trade when somebody is trying to do the right and legal thing and has to go through the red bureaucracy of having a taxi, or somebody completely shortcuts? So my point is, and this is my concern, because we saw the positions here. And let me briefly say, I'm just a citizen, I'm part of an informal initiative called Alternativa Drafted. I'm a Republican. I'm not an American citizen. My brother is. I worked with Americans for 25 years. Trump, don't like him, never liked him. But listen to the end. He's the first person, Republican, that I did not endorse in 33 years. I know American politics more than 99% of Americans, and I can prove that, even though it sounds like something arrogant to say. But however, It's one thing to belittle him. Many comments, and we saw some of the Bernie Sanders approach. Yes, I see some of the concerns. I see some of the middle America, which, by the way, America is not just the West Coast, the Northeast. In between, a lot of people voted for him. And yes, something they're very populist. There are these very complex issues to just blaming NAFTA or blaming this, when in fact there are many, many causes. But my point is this, we should not caricaturize him, make him just fun of him, you know, like some of the pictures. Because his administration is not completely equal with him. He has some smart people around him, both in matter of defense and in matter of economy. I don't like him, like I said, his style and stuff, but economically speaking, already some good things have happened lately. Same with Britain. So my question then is, how do we, especially professors, people who understand thought, who can quote Bastille and Hayek and all of that, and can criticize some other approaches, how can we bring more common sense, because somebody referred to common sense, how can we bring sense in all of this when people very easily go to positions, kind of like go to the, you know, cutting through the chase and attack each other, when we need a lot of pragmatism, not in the sense of just get things done, but in the sense of bringing that right perspective, because we live in a more complicated world. So how do we juggle all this ball without dropping the important ones?
Thank you very much. Let's have one more comment, or if we vote, we can get off the coffee break. If you have one back. Please. So yeah, quick comment, and then I will give. Just a second to the Barbara, and then we'll give to the coffee.
First of all, thank you for your being critical with regards to the comics. We decided to use them to attract people and really look at this, because I would not have voted probably for Trump, but at least, you know, the alternative, well, I'm glad I didn't have this choice. On the other hand, you're completely right when you criticize, or when you point out to the managed trade, Mexico, the sweatshops, the subsidies given by China, but this is exactly why we want entrepreneurs to survive. And Kristen, I'm really very thankful for your remarks, because what you said, I mean, Tesla was immediately the first thing that came to my mind. And many others. I mean, this is not a free market. And we should argue for the law of supply and demand that work there without any interventions. And just let the market control those things. And this is not where we are right now. And we talk about managed trade, and it's not free trade. So this is unfortunately the bad discussion. And I would, just one more sentence before we close and you have another intervention. I want the young people here to simply approach us, send us emails, send us questions, and also we would like to invite you. There is a project going on that is called Values for Europe, where we want to discuss, you know, factual, looking at facts and figures and the costs and the price tag that is on the so-called services of governments or of institutions. And let's look at that. If that's the future for Europe, or how we get to this future for Europe, and how we can fix the situation now, and I would like to invite you all to join and take part of that. The university will provide you with this information.
Thank you very much. Please.
Sorry.
Thank you. My name is Alexander Fuhrman, and I have a question. Apparently, and you spoke about it, you would like to have a free trade and free border, but basically that's a bit like anarchy for the state, because the state wants to control that. And the question is, how much free trade can you have when you don't have free trade in political systems? Because political systems are a monopoly of power. So you want to have, at the same time, market economy in goods, but monopoly in political systems, controlling that by every frontier.
Okay, so it seems like you want to answer to that.
I'm sorry, I think maybe you misunderstood me. I am for open borders, and I am for a Europe where nation states are able to make their own decisions as well, and where we don't have a centrally planned economy out of Brussels. This, I think, this is very, the subsidiarity principle is, I think, very important. And but again, you know, we have the democracies, luckily, although the democracy is not the optimal way of governing things, as Churchill has said once. But this is the only solution we have right now at hand. I mean, if you have a better one, please present it. I would love to hear it. But we can only deal with realities.
We only have somebody who wants to commit suicide, so I don't
know.
So,
metaphor.
Yeah, absolutely. You want to say something, and then we'll go for the coffee break and continue to fight there.
Short comment. Many of the decisions of the politicians that practically influence our lives here, and also free trade, it's also influenced by politicians, are due to the fact that they are acting in an with economical sense from their point of view, meaning that what they want to get, votes. So practically the actual form of the democratic system, it's influencing a lot of the decision in politics. And we know that democratic system, this wasn't always like this, and it's a perpetual transformation, even in the historic area, not on the short term. So our democratic system, as we know today, it's new from 100 years old, 200 years old, is based on universal votes, on, so it's quite new. So I think that let's say a challenge for the future, if we want to fix some of the things that are wrong now, basically we are all agreed that are wrong now, we should look below the political and we should look at the fundamentals of politics, which is the actual form of democracy. And I don't want to get so much into this discussion, but I just want to mention two things that could improve the democracy, meaning, for example, participatory budgeting, which could bring our possibility to influence the allocation of the resources, that ones who bring the resources to influence the allocation of the resources, which will decrease the importance of the universal vote overall. Yeah, it will increase our power toward politicians, influencing the budgeting. And another point is, more referendum, democracy, not via representative, but participatory. Yeah. So I guess the next step, what we should do as a society, and we will do practically on a historic, we will not remain on this system for good. This should be, because otherwise we are trying just to change the water in the glass with milk, with coffee, with everything you want, and we expect to have different format. It will not have different format. Look at the newspaper used to wrote 100 years ago, change few names, change few numbers, and you can put it today. It will be actual news. So we should look more advanced than actual politicians, let's say. We should change the format of the glass.
Thank you very much, so apparently we give up the coffee.
A very small comment. I was intrigued by a very wise question asked by Mr. Furman. What is the ideal degree of free trade that can we afford? And please prepare, I'm speaking both from my position as a scientist and journalist, and I'm giving you breaking news, so prepare your eyes and ears, or pens and papers. I will set something which will change the world for the rest of our lives, and the last of the regeneration that will come after us. The ideal degree of free trade as much as I can take it, as you can take it, as he can take it, as everybody can take it. This is the scientifically ideal amount of free trade. And there is some paradox, it's not a paradox, it's some asymmetry of perception. When you live in a free society, free trade society, you are allowed to be protectionist. When you live in a protectionist society, you're not allowed to be a free trader. Why I'm saying so? When you are in a free trade society, you have the right to listen to appeals which say, buy American, buy Romanian. Appeals, not policies, appeals. Please, would you be so kind to buy American? Buy from your own state, county, community, street. Help your community develop. Please do it so. I kindly ask you. This is a very fair and free protectionism, which you can afford only when free trade rules. The other ways do not apply.
Okay, thank you very much. With that, we conclude this panel. And
we have 10 minutes break.
Yeah, 10 minutes, okay.
Thank you.